Thanks be to God. Yes. Today is going to be a little bit different of a sermon. By now, you all know that I'm a public speaking coach, but I'm also a huge Bible nerd. Really, I get into this stuff, especially when trying to figure out the history of the script and going to social historical details. My wife watches me as I begin to collect a bunch of large books around me that gave me some very interesting insights to share right now with people. So today I'm going to be taking some of those educator skills and put them to work a little bit so that we can see something a little bit closer. I love parables because I find them relatable. Yet, there are some very, very tricky parables out there. And if one does not look deeper, they might get the wrong idea entirely. This is one of those that qualifies as the tricky ones, okay? Because the first time I read this, I was about 17 years old and working for $4.25 an hour at McDonald's. And it sounded like Jesus was telling me to rip off our bosses and give to our friends. And while I'm sure there are some who are like, Jesus said it. I told you, parables are relatable. We might be jumping the gun on that translation, at least in the context of today's world. I'm just going to go back to the historical time for some context of how estates were run and handled back then. For only a moment, because it is important to the context. First thing to consider, in ancient times, was the empowerment laws people had for things back then. They used the term slave in this passage, but that definition can also be just someone who is an extension of you in that world. So just imagine if you had debt out to local people and those people owed you things. It would, if you got so big that you geographically had to work things, you would work people in who would work much like a power of attorney on your behalf. These people would be trusted to be the top advisors and representatives for you because they would hold the same authority you would. Why did they do it like that? Well, it wasn't like they could dial someone up and check with the boss. There was no phone, no internet, no Zoom conferences. Back then, they needed to have a certain kind of trust that their managers would make good deals. And it seems that the shrewd manager was doing something wrong and was about to be thrown out. So it makes sense. And perhaps we can assume that the words, "What is this I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management because you cannot be my manager any longer," were sent through message. Since if it were done in person, then the manager would not have been able to do what the manager does next. And it also makes sense, the rich man wants him to provide an account of the receipts and records for what he was doing so he could fire them. That's the key here. He needs to know all the people who owed him things and how much. He needed a ledger so that he could have another person collect on the rich man's behalf. But that shrewd, sneaky manager, he ran a self-assessment. He says, I am too wimpy to go out there and dig, and I'm too proud to beg. But he is brave enough to begin working an exit strategy where the shrewd, sneaky, wimpy, prideful manager can find employment or favor in another household. So he devised a plan to get people's debt paid for less. Now, here is where the cultural context gets tricky. the numbers that they were using. 100 jugs of oil made 50, and 100 containers of wheat made 80. They might seem arbitrary, but many scholars believe that these were considered the commodity break-even points for the market at the time that Luke was written. Some even say that there are deeper hidden meanings around those numbers, but my suspicion, without an advanced scholarly degree in biblical numerology, yes, there is such a thing, this was the place where no profit was made. And Dr. Brandon Scott, a longtime professor at Phillips Theological Seminary, agrees that this was the margin point. So our manager decides he was basically having an unauthorized closing sale where everything must go at cost. Imagine what that might look like if somebody on a commercial level distribution sent out an email telling everyone that all of their inventory is at cost because they know they're getting fired for making bad deals. I doubt the corporation would be commending them for their action, would they? That manager would be sued, perhaps even face criminal prosecution, and most certainly they would not be commended. So of course, the debtors are now bound by honor to reciprocate the steward's gifts and benevolence. This manager now had a place to land, a couch to crash on, at the expense of only the rich man's profit. See, nothing in Scripture said he pocketed the money and ran off in embezzlement. It says he used some of that authority given to him from the rich man to write the rich man out of some of his money, but also settle the accounts up at the same time. He could have just as well have lost the bills and said nothing was owed, but he didn't. Perhaps that's why the boss commended him for acting so shrewdly. Now, here is something I need to bring up about this passage because it has some scriptural messiness to it. In verse 8, we see on overhead say, "And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light." Now, the second part, "For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the children of light," it is thought by many scholars around mainline Protestantism to be a scribal insertion that was written in the spaces between the script that had been mistaken for scripture when copied. This was originally discovered and written about by C.H. Dodd in 1935. But the problem is, some scholars think this is where the parable ended. And if you have a long education in parables, you might even agree, because this would have had already three elements that parables are supposed to have. One, something thought to be bad becomes something good. Two, the reversal of conventional logic. And three, they were meant to disorient and leave confused people asking for clarification. Other scholars can't tell where the redactions are, but feel very certain that this second part is almost assuredly a scribal error. But the sound of what is being said here has the almost sound of Jesus's judgments. See, though, rhetoric like "children of light" weren't thought to be used many years after Luke's creation. You will see it in the Gospel of John, which was written decades after the synoptics of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now, this gives a very different voice to the next line, and it makes a lot more sense, because 16:9 now could be something that came from the rich man to be his reasoning for commending that sneaky, shrewd, wimpy, prideful manager. Instead, people wonder if these words came from Jesus. Because that sound is coming from after the children of light. Instead, the addition of the scribal insertion from the margin sort of confuses where the next line is coming from. But wouldn't it make more sense, like the rich man, to say, "And I tell you, make friends by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it's gone, they may welcome you." If Jesus said, "Use dishonest wealth," we might have a problem, right? It would make sense that the kind of ethics where you take from one person to gain favor from another person is the kind of the ethics the world asks from us. And you critical thinkers are probably then wondering why they said something like they are welcoming you into eternal homes. Well, lots of people have discussed that wording through time. Some believe that Jesus is claiming the debtors as his followers by referencing that this wimpy, shrewd, pride, sneaky manager should find rest in the eternal. And that when people are discarded from the world of evil, that a Christian may be the one that welcomes them into their homes. Because think about this for a moment. If all this happens, the shrewd manager doing what we say in prayer, isn't he forgiving debt while also his debt was forgiven? Whatever the case, it really is confusing. But thankfully, this whole thing gets summed up in the next few verses because it's about trust and understanding the basic principles of the world. See, this shrewd manager is a little like all of us, though. All of us, having to negotiate survival and ethics. It could be as innocent as speeding on the way to work, or a little lie to keep something or something off our backs. Or it can be as big as people who start fudging the numbers on financial records so they can keep people employed and money moving in desperate times. Or even the new things I hear in America. The other side's doing it, so if we don't do it, we'll lose. When did we get to the point where ethics became good enough? Or that's the way things are done now? We defend people and celebrities we know are problematic because they're on our side. Or we have a bias. They could score touchdowns, so whatever they did, we hope doesn't get in their way of our hopes for our team and he can play. Or perhaps it's our guy who can bring change to the world just the way we want it by getting a bill pushed through, but we need the most ruthless and wicked ethically challenged people to fight for us. But they forgot our ideals along the way. All that stuff that we think is so important is about to fall apart. That's the world's ethics. And that's what happens in the world's playground. The stuff that will divide us and ask each other to stab each other in the back, just like that shrewd, wimpy, proud, sneaky backstabbing manager did. But even the rich man realized that this shrewd manager was playing by the world's ethics, and thus have done nothing wrong by the world's standards. By the world's standards, he was commended and even given refuge. What a great guy, right? Well, Jesus doesn't think so. He said, "Whoever is faithful in very little is faithful also in much. Whoever is dishonest in very little is dishonest also in much." So yeah, he was dishonest. And if you have not been faithful with dishonest wealth, who will entrust you to the true riches? Right? No one is going to give you the good stuff if you're acting shady from the start. So Jesus is telling us all to make the moral and upright outstanding choices. Jesus wants us to reject the values which are opposite of the values of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus even says so. We can only serve one master. Then why are we trying to use bad things for good purposes? Whose ethics are we serving anyway? We feel that pressure to perform, to live to society's standards, to keep up with the Joneses, to have the American dream. And once we begin to compromise the ethics a little, it becomes a slippery slope. Things like lying on a credit app for a better interest rate, because it's just become part of the game until the game is over and you lost. Money can be the root of all evil or even a helpful tool. But that is typically determined by the ethics of the person wielding it. Are your ethics serving God or yourself? Are your ethics trapped against the wills of survival like shrewd manager? Do you feel compromised and like a slave to those pressures of the world? And do they ever relent? We need faith. We need to hand that over to Jesus. Trust that if you are doing well and not being shady, that it'll all work out. I'll close with a little story. I'm not always the good guys in my stories, so this one makes me a little bit happier than most. Last year, I started my inquiry to ordination around this time. I was not able to pay for school because a new governmental administration put different regulations around student loans for disabled veterans. I was going to let that be my excuse to stop for a while. Laurel was not going to let me take a year off, though. She came up with a plan, and the Presbytery gave me $3,000 to act as a stopgap for tuition until more money was found. Well, more money was found by the VA, and I was accepted into their vocational rehabilitation program, and they paid for all of my schooling. But they also paid for the same schooling that the Presbytery did, and I had a surplus sitting in a school account for about a year until they had finally sent me a check. $3,000 was sitting in my lap. With everything going on this summer, with the move and getting married and all that, it would have been nice to have less than acceptable ethics and keep that money. No one probably even thought about the money at that point. But I felt that to use something like that for what I need is great. But to keep what I don't require is not so great. I wanted to choose the better. And so does Jesus of all of us. So I returned the money to the presbytery the first chance I got to not let that money tempt me. And I'm glad I did. But let us evaluate the ethics that we live by. Let us ask, who do they serve? Are they yours? Are these ethics the world's? Or are they the rules we would live by in the kingdom of heaven? And then if the answers are no, let us not serve two gods. Let us serve only one, our God in heaven, who sent us Jesus and grace. Amen.